Hello, and welcome to the latest episode of the Informing Choices mini-pod. In the newly published book, Aftershocks and Opportunities 2, Navigating the Next Horizon, editor and author Rohit Talwar explores the 20 emerging future factors that could turn into influential shifts shaping the next decade and beyond. The shifts he identifies can be characterized under the headings operating environment, lives and lifestyles, economy, and business and technology. So to discuss shifts on the path to 2030, I'm delighted to welcome back global futurist, international keynote speaker and CEO of Fast Future, Rohit Talwar, to the podcast. Rohit, first of all, give us a brief reintroduction to you and then tell us a little bit about this book.
Well, firstly, thank you for having me on the show, Steve. I am a futurist. I work with clients around the world, helping them anticipate and respond to the forces, the shifts and the shocks that might shape the future. And we've written a number of books, which you have co-edited. And this latest book was really an attempt to explore a year on or 18 months on from the start of the pandemic. How are people viewing our world changing in the next decade or so? So we pulled together 37 future thinkers from around the world. We put a call out. We had literally 100 or so submissions. We did one book in June of 2020, and then this latest one, which is really a year and a half on, saying what might change and how might it change and what are scenarios for the future. Fascinating range of topics from sustainable agriculture to geopolitical conflicts. Really, really interesting stuff. And that came out on September 28th.
Fascinating. And I know from my own experience, as you say, there is this wonderful range of different perspectives. But let's focus on one of your contributions to the book, because you lay out 20 shifts on the path to 2030. And while a number of those shifts are arguably on trend, which would you highlight as having been supercharged by the pandemic?
So I think a couple that really stand out for me. One is this idea of Corporation Zero. So a lot of companies were faced with this challenge of trying to manage a distributed workforce when they really hadn't designed themselves to operate that way. And it's driven a lot of companies to say, well, we need to automate more of our processes to reduce the reliance on humans, which obviously has some very difficult challenges to it for society. But what we're discovering is that organizations aren't always brilliant at digital transformation, which is why 60, 70, 80% either fail or don't deliver on their ambitions. And it's because organizations are so complex and we're trying to overlay this digital technology on organizations that still think very manually about how they do things in very analog ways. And there's a lot of people, there's a lot of complex decision making, there's a lot of emotion, a lot of structure and people managing their kingdoms or their queendoms or whatever you want to call them. And so people are saying, well, hang on, let's look at what's going on in the world of new ventures, where they actually don't start with people, buildings or kit, whatever they're doing. They start with a blank sheet of paper and they design the business in digital. They work out what outcomes they're trying to achieve, what inputs they need, what do they need to monitor in order to tell them how well they're doing as a business. And then they design all the processes in digital. And then they work out, well, okay, where do we need to have humans? Where do we need some physical premises? Where do we need equipment? Because maybe we're in manufacturing or whatever. And what information do we need back from all of those physical elements, which is a totally different way of thinking. And it's this idea of Corporation Zero. And so we're seeing a real acceleration in that, where companies just simply weren't talking that way. But that combination of the pandemic, intense competition in the marketplace, and a massive need to trim costs and therefore headcount, and the enabling power of the technology has really got people thinking very differently. And then you're seeing this notion of decentralized autonomous organizations coming from crypto and blockchain world, where they design these businesses where no humans are going to be involved, and the community that own the tokens for that business, i.e. the shares, they vote on everything. They propose the changes, they vote on everything, and then they decide who the contractors are that are going to come in and change anything in the software. And so these models are becoming more and more visible and really forcing organizations to rethink how they're going to do business for the future and what their business model is. And so, you know, and partly it's the economics that's driving that. So if I'm in financial services, I might pay someone 0.1% interest on their savings, but I may be charging 5% interest on the mortgages I lend out. And I can lend out multiple times the money I take in because of fractional reserve banking. So what you're seeing in the crypto world is, because there's no employees, the bulk of that money can be given back to the individual. So you can lend money basically into these so-called decentralized exchanges and get interest rates of, you know, 5 to 10% on your cash, and 100% or more if you buy certain cryptocurrencies and invest them. So it's forcing a change in thinking, and that's why this move to entirely digital is becoming so prominent.
I mean, if I can take you back to something you said back at the beginning there, you were talking about transformation. And I think there's almost a point where, in my view, we need to kind of separate digital from other elements of transformation, because some of the challenges I think that you're alluding to there were much more about change and being more entrepreneurial within the existing organization, given particularly the nature of new startups and new players coming into the marketplace. So you know, how do you view the difference between a digital focus and one that's much more about, if you like, human-centric change and entrepreneurship, more human characteristics, I suppose?
Well, so the digital bit, in terms of designing the digital piece and implementing it, is the easy part. The difficult part is the people. And so we're seeing a few things where I think we're going to see a lot more organizations breaking up into smaller entities that can be more self-managing. The center might give them the technology to work with no argument. And the people are really focused around serving customers, winning business, delivering, responding to customer requirements, and maybe product innovation, but a lot less around process and technology innovation.
Yeah.
And the corporate center then becomes much more of a kind of venture capital model, but with process and technology as well as money going to these side businesses. And I think keeping it small is critical to delivering fast change, creating culture, particularly when you've got people working from home. You've got people joining organizations now who've never met their colleagues. And that changes culture, because you're not in the workplace, you're not seeing how things happen for real, you're not seeing the power dynamics, you're not seeing how conversations happen, you're not being able to go and have a 10-second conversation with someone on how to do things, you're not bumping into people, and you just can't replicate a lot of that stuff online. And so that's changing cultures. And although you can have bigger and bigger global teams virtually, it becomes harder and harder to kind of actually manage in a way that you're connected to people. And that's why I think these smaller entities, maybe moving back to more geographically based entities as well, could become increasingly the norm.
I love how that conversation's kind of has moved away from the core proposition you spoke about there to some of the more human and organizational structural changes that we might be seeing. So notwithstanding the potential to continue to kind of build connections on your core point there, you know, what is the second shift that you would point to? What is the second of those 20?
Well, I think it's all around money. And I think one of the things that happened during the pandemic was people had a lot of time on their hands, or some people had a lot of time on their hands, and they started to investigate cryptocurrencies. And so what we saw is that the size of the crypto economy grew from just under 200 billion globally at the start of 2020 to around $2 trillion today. And that's massive. And people just saw what was going on, and they put a little bit of money into Bitcoin and Ethereum, some of these other coins, and then they watched them skyrocket. And actually, though, even though there's been a recent kind of bit of volatility, if you invested around that time in Bitcoin, depending on exactly when you invested, you've seen a 10 to 20 to 40% 4 to 40 times return on the money you invested. And that's got people really interested. And so we're seeing it grow at the fastest rate of any technology in terms of user adoption. The size of the network, over 300 million people now, on course for about a billion by 2024. And we could potentially be at the point where within 5 years, the crypto economy could be at least 50% of the size of global stock markets, which are around $160 trillion today. And it's really that focus. And then what's been interesting is that the financial markets basically hoarded their cash during the downturn, and they're looking for where the best place to put it is. And that's kind of led into two things, which is really me blurring two of the shifts. One is they're all pouring into crypto, whatever they say publicly. If you see what's going on behind the scenes, they're setting up funds, they're taking high net worth clients in, they're all taking positions in crypto. That's led to a lot of corporates. Over 100 public companies have now declared that they have cryptocurrency on their balance sheet because they can make more money, between 4 and 7%. But the other thing that's been happening is the corporate shift into housing. And now, if you look in the US, companies like Blackstone are buying up entire towns of properties. And Blackstone is now the biggest owner of private accommodation in the US. And over 200 companies there are bought in. Here in the UK, you've got more obvious candidates like Lloyds Bank, but even people like John Lewis looking at buying property to put on their balance sheet. Why? Because you can get a much higher return on that than the cash you've got in the bank, because we've had effectively 0% interest rates since 2008. And so you're seeing these really interesting shifts around how people use their money. And I think those are big things that really got accelerated by the pandemic. The housing one's fascinating because they're tapping into a few different things. One is, where's the best place to put my money? The second is that automation is kind of driving people out of their jobs in the short term. And the banks and the people who are investing are saying, well, actually, those people are going to end up cash. A lot of people are going to end up selling their property in order to raise money to live. And then they'll need to live somewhere. So we'll sell them. We'll buy their house and then rent it back to them. And thirdly, you've kind of got this broader shift in society where Klaus Schwab, World Economic Forum, has put out this message that, I think it's by 2030, no one will own anything, we'll all rent everything and we'll all be happy. And we'll move to this rental society. Maybe it's 2040. But they're tapping into that and they're saying this is an obvious thing. And then they can access money far cheaper than anyone else. They can access money on the commercial markets for 0.5% to 1% interest. So even if they're paying a premium to buy the property, it's costing them a lot less. So, I've actually given you three shifts there.
Yeah.
the corporation zero and this decentralized autonomous organizations, the rise of the crypto economy and the corporatization of housing.
Absolutely fascinating. And one of the things that always strikes me is when we start to talk about these shifts is the interconnected nature of them as well. So I'm sure that you have whetted people's appetite to find out more about the book. So first of all, where can people find out about the book? And then where can people find out about you, Rohit?
So you can find out about both at our website, fastfuture.com. And just go to the bookstore for that book and its predecessors. And then if you want to find out more about me and what I'm saying, what I'm writing, you can find me on Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter. And there are very few Rohit Talwars in there. So, but I'm not the one who posts rude things about Indian Bollywood stars. That's not me.
And I also know you're not the one that opens the batting for India.
Rohit Sharma, yeah.
Rohit, thank you so much for your time. And thank you, everyone, for listening. Do let your friends and colleagues know about the Informing Choices mini pod, and there'll be another episode along very soon.